I want you to remember that God's created everything you see. He breathed it into existence. You remember when his people were caught up in slavery? He rescued them. What he did was he parted the sea and he made a way for them. And then he delivered their enemies to them, and he unlocks wombs, and he provides water from a rock, and he provides manna from heaven, and he brought down the walls of Jericho. He froze the sun, allowing victory. He's toppled giants with tiny stones. He's brought fire from heaven. He shut the mouths of lions. He preserved life in the belly of a well. He's fed thousands with a few loaves. He gives the weak strength. He heals the sick. He's made the blind see, the deaf hear, the mute speak, the lame walk, and he's overcome evil, and he's made a way through death for you and me by the death and the resurrection of his son, Jesus Christ, that we will live with him forever. We will dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever and ever and ever. What are we afraid of? His resume is flawless. He controls everything. And he loves you.
Hey everyone, welcome, and thank you for joining us here at Calvary Baptist Church for a teaching time before your discussion groups. We hope that this is going to be a blessing for you in kind of the craziness of what's going on right now. I don't know if you're already going stir crazy, but I am. And I started watching YouTube videos and Facebook videos to get me through. Go figure. And one of the videos I watched about a week ago, and it was about this guy who had this sock on his hand. I'm sure you've seen it. He's standing by a window, and there's a street out there, and he's acting like the sock is eating the cars that drive by. It's really dumb, but it's funny. And all of a sudden, like within a week, I looked at it yesterday, and there was over 30 million views on that. 30 million people watched that guy with the sock on his hand pretending to eat cars. And things can escalate quickly, and we know that. Things can go viral on the internet, but things can also escalate quickly in our lives, and that's what this past week has seemed. It seems like every hour, every day, there's some kind of new information out there. And we pray that this would be a beneficial time for the church, that we would see the gospel become viral, the church become viral, the people of God be called out to do what God called them to, like the first church. The first church was viral. The first church, they started with 120 people in the upper room, and the Holy Spirit of God moved them. God called them to go, to scatter, to seek those that were lost, to tell them the good news about Jesus, and they did that. And all of a sudden, Peter stands up and preaches, and in one day, in 1 hour, however long it was, 3,000 people get saved. 3,000 people added to the church. A couple of days later, 5,000 got added to the church. And throughout the book of Acts, as the church is growing, you see it has these phrases like the gospel spread quickly, and those that got saved were added to the church, and the word of God went out, and so-and-so preached, and the gospel spread throughout all the region, and God added to the church. And there's those little phrases several times throughout the book of Acts, and it all started with when people of God got serious about the things of God, and they believed the gospel in God so much that God used them greatly. And we believe right now that God can use this time in our lives. You see, the people that got saved in Acts chapter 2, it says they gladly received the word, were baptized, and on that day about 3,000 souls were added to the church, added to them. And so what do you do when you get 3,000 people that are saved? What do you do? And verse 42, it tells us they continue steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine, in fellowship, in breaking of bread, and in prayers. And later it goes on to say in verse 46 that they continued daily in one accord. They were in unity in the temple and also in the house, house to house. And I feel like that's what we're doing now. I feel like we're kind of going old school, going back to what God has first called the church to be, to his, be his people, to devote themselves to four things. And we believe if we do those four things that we will see God add to the church. We'll see people get saved. And the four things that they committed to were the Bible, the apostles' doctrine, community, gathering together, the fellowship, encouraging one another, loving one another. The third thing is generosity. It says breaking of bread, and often we think that is communion, but the breaking of bread, what they were talking about there specifically is the there was a lot of need. There was financial need. Not everybody had food. Not everybody had resources to live. And so what the early church did is they came together and generously all brought stuff together so that no one would have need. And so every day they came together in houses and they broke bread. Somebody would bring the macaroni and cheese, and somebody would bring the meat, and somebody, kind of like an old school potluck, but what that symbolizes is, what that means is, they were generous. They didn't hoard it. They didn't say, oh, this is my toilet paper, this is my hand sanitizer. What they did is, if you don't have enough food, come to my house and we'll take care of you in Jesus' name. And so they were generous. So they got the Bible, they had community, they had generosity, and lastly, they had dependency upon God in prayer. And they prayed together, and they loved God together, and they knew what was going on in their world was out of their control, but they knew it wasn't out of God's control. And so they came together to really show their dependency and faith in God. You see, I believe that that God is always, throughout history and even in church history, God has always used famines. He's always used persecution. He's always used disasters and things we wouldn't think God would use, but he uses those things to accomplish his purpose. You think about the Tower of Babel, those people, they wanted to come together and they wanted to hang out and do their own thing, and said, God said, no, 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 no. And this crazy disaster, this chaotic thing where everybody's speaking different languages and it makes them scatter. I think about Joseph's family and what they meant for evil, God meant for good. And they sold Joseph off, and now years later, he's in a position of authority. And God wants to bring their family together. God wants to provide for their family. And so God sends a famine to the land where Joseph's family is, and they've got to go to Joseph. I think about the persecution that with Moses, God wants to lead his people out of slavery, out of bondage, out of Egypt. And he uses something we wouldn't use, plagues, these natural crazy disasters, miracles. And we always think that it was just for the Egyptians, but the Egyptians and the Israelites had to go through it. And it was this crazy time. In fact, the Israelites said, Moses, what are you doing? You promised us a better future. You promised us a freedom. You promised us that God was going to lead us out. And yet, Moses, you're making things worse. You're bringing chaos into our lives. And God uses plagues, something we wouldn't think. And so, even in the early church wanted to sit in Jerusalem, hang out in Jerusalem, and they wanted to hang out with their friends and just wait till God came back. And God used persecution, specifically of Saul and others, to make those people scatter, to go to the ends of the world. You have the hope of the world. You have the gospel. Take it to wherever God has called you to. Don't just hoard it. Don't just sit. But God uses famines and persecutions and diseases and disasters and chaos in our lives to make us uncomfortable so that we depend on him, but also take his message to the world. I think about this story as we kind of gather together. I want to bring some hope to you. And my hope, first of all, is that you are encouraged during this time, that we believe if we devote ourselves to these four things, the Bible, community, generosity, and prayer, we believe that God can even use the coronavirus and use the church during this time to bring hope to the world. Well, what is that hope? The hope is that God is still on his throne, that God is still reigning and ruling in power and might. This past few weeks have made me think of one of my favorite stories in the Bible, and it's in 2 Chronicles chapter 20. If you got your Bible, 2 Chronicles chapter 20, and it's this story. If you know anything about Chronicles is just telling about how God had moved and God is acting on the behalf of his people, on the behalf of kings. And one of the kings right now is a man named Jehoshaphat, and he is the ruler. He's the king over Judah. And I won't give you all the details, but in verse 1 and 2, somebody comes to the king and tells him that tragedy is coming. There's a vast army, and not just one army, but not just two armies, but three armies are coming to destroy the nation. And what is the nation going to do? You see, sometimes in our lives, we freak out, and it's not just one thing. It's not two things, but when it rains, it pours. And maybe today you're dealing with the stress and fear of the coronavirus. Maybe there's frustration of not being able to continue life as it goes, but maybe it's also the broken marriage or the broken home or the broken relationship you're dealing with too. Maybe it's the loved ones that were in the tornado's path in Tennessee last week. Maybe you got a diagnosis or a phone call, or maybe you got stabbed in the back last week by somebody you thought was your friend. You see, maybe it's a vast thing coming at you, and we're going to see how they respond in verse 3. Jehoshaphat feared. The man came in verse 2 saying a great multitude is coming. In verse 3, it says Jehoshaphat feared. You see, it's okay to be afraid as long as you know where to take your fear. It's okay to not have all the answers as long as you know about the one who is in control, who does have the answers. And it says in verse 3 that he set himself, he resolved, he set himself apart. He pursued to seek the Lord. He resolved in his heart to seek the Lord, and he proclaimed a fast throughout all of Judah. See, Jehoshaphat was fearful, but he was also resolved to seek the one who had control of the situation. And that's what God is calling us to. In fact, they did a fast. What a fast is, to set apart everything that is distracting you from what God wants for you. That you set apart all the things that are busy. There's so many things in our lives that are busy. Even during this time when the world shuts down, we go home and we turn on the TV, or we play a video game, or we stand on Facebook and we start freaking out and we're fearful. And God says, no, I want you to set those things apart. And during this time, I want you to set your eyes on me. I want you to seek me. And if there's a tragedy or something going on in your life, a trial in your life, that trial can be a good thing if it draws your heart closer to God. Let me say that one more time. That trial in your life can be a good thing if it draws you closer to God. He goes on to pray, and the whole nation is seeking, the whole nation is fasting, and they pray this great prayer in verse 6. And they say, O Lord, God of our fathers, are you not God in heaven? Do you not rule over the kingdom of the nations? In your hand is there not power and might, so that no one is able to withstand you? What they're saying is, that's all rhetorical questions. Of course, God is in heaven. Of course, that God rules and reigns over the kingdoms of all the nations. Of course, God is all powerful and almighty. Of course, there is no one able to withstand him. What they're doing there is they see God, who he rightfully is and where he rightfully is, and they see that God is still seated on his throne. If you need hope today, you need to look to God, who is on his throne. He's not He's not standing up. He's not panicking. He's not pacing back and forth. He's not anxious today. He is confidently sitting on his throne. And in fact, in the New Testament, in Hebrews 8, Romans 8, Colossians chapter 3, and even in the Old Testament, Psalm 46 talks about God is sitting on his throne. And in Romans, Hebrews 8 says the world is his footstool. Nothing is coming at God. Whatever's going on in your life today, whatever's going on in the world today, you need to know that God is faithful and he's still on his throne. Also, what they do in verse 7 through 11, they start to recall all the good things that God has done, all the faithful things that God has done, that God took the Israelites out of Egypt, that they crossed the Red Sea, that even all the crazy things that they thought, there is no way out. They start recalling all of the miracles, all the faithfulness of God. And one of the verses I want to hone in on is in verse 9. It says, if disaster comes upon us, do you feel like there's disaster in your life? Whether it's sword, judgment, pestilence, disease, or even famine, we will stand before the temple and in your presence, for in your name is in this temple, and we will cry out to you in our affliction, and you will hear us and you will save us. They had confidence in the faithfulness of God. They saw him do it in the past and they know he will do it again. I love that in the midst of persecution, in the midst of famine, in the midst of disease, in the midst of your trial, that they stood in the temple. They stood with the believers of that day, the ones who had faith in God, and they praised God and they prayed to God. And they trusted that who he was faithful in the past will be faithful to do it again. And they believed that God would save them. The last part of their prayer and last part of their thing is in verse 12. And it's a really confession of where they are, because it says, oh, our God, will you not judge them? The people, the nations that are coming against them. For we have no power against them. This great multitude that is coming against us, nor do we know what to do, but our eyes are upon you. We don't have power. No, that's you. We don't have might. That's you. We don't even know what to do. We don't have control over the situation. But even in the midst of the chaos, our eyes are on you. Our eyes are focused on you. We're waiting on you. We're praising you. We're trusting you, God. And they replace their self-dependency with God's ability. God, I don't have the ability to do this, but I know you do. And they trust and have faith that God is going to come through. And I love how this kind of story wraps up is while they're praising God, while they're worshiping God, while they're trusting God, they're not running around making plans. They're not running around gathering their weapons. They're not running around freaking out. Instead, all they're doing is worshiping and waiting and trusting that God has been faithful, that God is on his throne, that God is still able to do what he said he's going to do. And while they're worshiping, while they're praising God in community, in fasting, in praying, and hoping, essentially what the New Testament did, all those 120 that are in the upper room, they're waiting and they're praying and they're expecting for God to show up and do what he said he was going to do. And while they're doing that, a priest, a Levite, comes up to them and tells them a message for God. And it says, thus says the Lord to you. This is the promise to you. Do not. Everybody say, do not. Do not. Did you say it? All right. Do not be afraid nor dismayed because of this great multitude. Don't freak out about what's going on, because the battle is not yours, but it is God's. Some of you may need to know this morning, because you've been stressing and trying and working and trying to fight a battle that's not yours. Maybe today you're here and you're listening and you've been trying to fight a battle for a long time and you're worn out. Maybe today you need to just trust in the Almighty God that He's on His throne, that He is faithful, and that He has the ability to save you. Not only from this earthly disaster or destruction or virus, not only from the earthly stuff and the relationships that you're going through right now, but there is an eternal hope for you in heaven one day. The Bible says that there is no one righteous, that we're on the throne of our lives and we're enemies of God and we don't want to do what God has already called us to do. And the Bible says that we are all sinners. What sin is disobedience to God and selfishness toward mankind. And God says in that, the penalty, the payment is death, an eternal death in hell forever. But the Bible says that there is hope because God loved you so much that He sent His only Son, Jesus Christ, to die a sinner's death, to live a perfect life, to die a sinner's death, to take the wrath that was due you on Him. The Bible says that when you do that, when He did that, He offered you a free gift. He offered you hope of eternal life. And He did that by being your substitute, by standing in your place. In fact, today is the day that you can accept Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. The Bible says there's three things you have to do for salvation to come to you. For if you want not just earthly hope, which God wants an earthly hope for you. God wants an abundant life for you, but He also wants to give you a heavenly hope, an eternal hope. And the Bible says you can have that eternal hope by admitting that you are a sinner. Admit that you've been on the throne of your life. Admit that you've been an enemy of God. And then believe that Jesus Christ is who He said He is. He is the Son of God. And He did what He said He was going to do, that He died in your place. And the Bible says when you confess Him as Lord, when you take yourself off the throne of your life and you invite Jesus to be the Lord of your life, you surrender control of your life to Him, the Bible says that you will be saved. If that's you today, if you're sitting in a home, I'm just going to ask you to close your eyes and bow your heads. If there's other people in your room, would you close your eyes and bow your heads as well? And if that's you and you want eternal hope today, would you repeat this prayer after me? Dear Lord, I know that I'm a sinner and I know I deserve death. Lord, thank You for sending Your Son, Jesus Christ, to die on a cross in my place. God, I give You control of my life, and I invite You to sit on the throne of my life, and that I will follow You for all of eternity. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. If that's you, I just want to give you a round of applause. I just want to celebrate with you. The Bible says if you said that prayer and admit it in your heart and you confess it, that you are saved, that eternity is now where you are headed in heaven with God forevermore. And I want to celebrate you with you. If you're in a room with other people, we want to celebrate with you. Maybe you're watching this online. I just want you to click the link above that says, I accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. We want to give you a free gift. If you're sitting in a room with people, tell them we want to celebrate with you. At this time, what I want you to do, if you're in a small group, to go ahead and pause the video, turn off the video, and there's some discussion questions, and I would love for you to talk more about what the early church looked like and how we can have hope and what we learned out of 2 Chronicles chapter 20. We hope that you have a great day.